أعوذ بالله السميع العليم من الشيطان اللعين الرجيم. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. الحمد لله رب العالمين. الحمد لله والحمد حقه كما يستحقه حمدا كثيرا. وأعوذ به من شر نفسي، إن النفس لأمارة بالسوء إلا ما رحم ربي. والصلاة والسلام على أشرف الأنبياء والمرسلين، خاتم النبيين، سيدنا وحبيب قلوبنا وشفيع ذنوبنا أبي القاسم محمد. وعلى أهل بيته الطيبين الطاهرين المعصومين المطهرين المكرمين. السلام عليك سيدي ومولاي يا أبا عبد الله، وعلى الأرواح التي حلت بفنائك. عليك مني سلام الله أبدا ما بقيت، وبقي الليل والنهار، ولا جعله الله آخر العهد مني لزيارتكم. السلام على الحسين وعلى علي بن الحسين وعلى أولاد الحسين وعلى أصحاب الحسين جميعا ورحمة الله وبركاته. قال الله سبحانه وتعالى في محكم كتابه الكريم، بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم: يا بني آدم قد أنزلنا عليكم لباسا يواري سوآتكم وريشا، ولباس التقوى ذلك خير. آمنا بالله، صدق الله العلي العظيم. For the purification of the souls and the enlightenment of the hearts and for the hastening of the reappearance of the awaited Savior عجل الله تعالى فرجه الشريف. Enlighten your souls and the atmosphere with the recitation of salawat upon Muhammad wa Ali Muhammad. Respected elders, brothers and sisters in Islam, assalamu alaykum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. It was the 1st of July 2009. An Egyptian lady who had German citizenship was in an area in Germany known as Dresden. She was inside the court and she was giving a testimony against a man who had been abusive towards her a while earlier in the playground. That individual had called her an Islamic terrorist. She gave the witness. Once she finished, she was allowed by the judge to leave the court alongside her husband and her three-year-old child. When she was about to leave, the man who was accused of insulting her immediately rushed towards her with a kitchen knife. He stabbed her 18 times. And when her husband tried to defend her, the husband was stabbed 15 times. At that moment, a police officer was called inside the court. The police officer mistook the husband for the attacker. Therefore, he shot the husband who was already stabbed. And after a few moments, the lady passed away and died inside the court. The case of this particular Muslima by the name of Marwa al-Sherbini was indeed an incident that caused outrage in many parts of the world, especially in Egypt and in several other countries. Here was an individual who was adorning the Islamic dress code of hijab, and she was attacked in an apparent racist and homophobic aggressive attack. And therefore she was referred to and today is called the martyr of the hijab. The case of Marwa al-Shirbini has indeed been added to the long discussion that exists out there about the importance of the Islamic dress code known as hijab and the issues and the connotations associated with it. For instance, we find that certain countries like France have banned the full Islamic veil publicly and importantly at educational establishments such as schools and universities. A lady by the name of Senit Dungaray in 2004, what she did was, in protest against the ban on hijab, she shaved her hair completely, and she went to school, thereby drawing the attention of the media, who came and spoke about her stance in order to highlight her right to adorn the Islamic dress code known as hijab. This subject is therefore quite important because it keeps coming up and also takes precedence during the commemoration of the revolution of the Holy Third Imam and his family and companions in Karbala. Because the approach towards discussing hijab has been several fold. You have one school of thought who comes forward and says, in response to people who say that hijab is something which is cultural and has been made obligatory by the men. It is the men who control things, and therefore they are the ones who placed hijab. Some group of people have come forward to answer this, and the methodology they've used, and sometimes from the minbar, is to frighten our sisters when it comes to adorning the hijab. In which way? In the idea that they say that the human being acts upon knowledge. If you and I know that, for instance, a glass of water has some poison in it, we've been told definitely that there is some poison in this cup of water, you and I will not go about drinking it because we have the knowledge that it will harm us. What these group of individuals, this school of thought in the discussion surrounding hijab do, is that they give narrations about the punishment that awaits individuals and our sisters specifically when they do not adorn the hijab. So when you discuss it with them, they'll tell you that there is a story at the time of Ayatullah al-Uzma, al-Sayyid Abu al-Qasim al-Khu'i, Ridwanullahi ta'ala alayh, the great marja'. At his time, there was a Kuwaiti man who had his sister in Iraq pass away. His sister was not wearing hijab. She was not a hijabi. When she passed away, they came to bury her. When they placed her inside the grave, he was mourning and he was crying and he was next to her body inside the grave, and the grave eventually was sealed. When he went back to the hotel, he recognized that his passport was not there and began to think that the passport had fallen where? Inside the grave. He went to Ayatullah al-Khu'i and he said to him, is it possible for me to open up the grave to take my passport? Why? Because at that time it was difficult to attain the passport. And indeed there was a special circumstance behind it. The marja' said to him, you are allowed to only in exceptional circumstances. And it is this case that it is exceptional. Therefore you can open up the grave. He said, I went and opened up the grave, and to my shock and horror, I saw my sister without a kafan. There she was, without any covering. I took my passport, sealed the grave, and went running towards the marja. I said to him, Maulana Sayyiduna, this is what I saw. I was indeed very much shaken by this sight. Sayyid al-Khu'i said to him, did your sister wear hijab? He says, no. At that moment, the marja' said, Sadaqa Rasulullah, that the Messenger of Allah is indeed truthful. Why? Because the Messenger of Allah, Muhammadin al-Mustafa sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sallam, mentions in a hadith that is narrated, whomsoever does not wear hijab and passes away and meets the Lord, the Malaika will take away their shroud as form of punishment. And therefore this was documented. Some people come forward and within this particular ideology tell us about the punishment that entails, or it is written for whom? For the sisters that do not wear the hijab or do not wear it in accordance with the Sharia law. They say that on the day of judgment, the Holy Prophet saw the different women that were hanging from the hair and the different punishments that they go in detail that I do not wish to go through. Therefore, there is this idea that emerges. Yet, there is another school of ideology when it comes to hijab, and they say that when it comes to this particular Islamic dress code of modesty and chastity, we need to be able to explain to our sisters the philosophy and the ethos behind hijab, so that when they wear the hijab, they wear it with conviction, pride, and honor. They wear it with understanding as to why is it that Allah has made this obligatory. And this particular school divides itself into two. One branch comes and says, first and foremost, we need to educate and inform the masses, including the male, the fathers, the brothers, about whether hijab is wajib or not. Because there are people out there in the world today that they say hijab is not wajib, that this is the work of some scholars that they have indeed instigated and established. The question is hijab wajib or not? Which has to be answered. Indeed, you look at all Muslim jurisprudential schools of thought, Sunni and Shia, within the five divisions of the Islamic jurisprudential schools of thought, you'll find that all the scholars unanimously say that hijab is wajib. No doubt about it. We have no mainstream opinion from any school of thought that say that there is a question mark over the obligatory aspect of the Islamic dress code known as hijab. Number one. Number two, there are two verses in the Quran that clearly indicate the obligatory nature of hijab. The first one is found in chapter 24, Surah An-Nur, verse 30 and 31. That particular ayah in the Quran highlights what? It highlights the covering of the head as well as the neck. وَلْيَضْرِبْنَ بِخُمُرِهِنَّ عَلَى جُيُوبِهِنَّ. The Quran says, let them place the khimar is the head covering, over the jiyub. The jiyub is the chest area as well as the head. So this is one area. If you look at chapter 33, Surah Al-Ahzab, verse number 59, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, يَا أَيُّهَا النَّبِيِّ قُلْ لِأَزْوَاجِكَ وَبَنَاتِكَ أَنْ يُدْنِينَ عَلَيْهِنَّ مِنْ جَلَابِيبِهِنَّ. Say, O Prophet, to your daughters and to your wives, that they should wear the jilbab. What is the jilbab? The jilbab is a loose article of clothing over their bodies. Therefore, the scholars have come forward and says these two verses in the Quran are quite explicit and are quite clear in saying that the hijab of the lady, of a female, of a Muslimah is the following, and mark these words. The hijab should not be transparent, it should be loose, and it should cover their entire body except the face and the hands until the wrist. Those are the definition of the hijab. In other words, it should be loose, not attractive, and it should be fully covering, including the hair, of course. This is the definition that is given about hijab, because today, many people have given their own definition of hijab. You have, for instance, the yo-yo hijab. The brothers may not be aware of it, but the sisters are already smiling. The yo-yo hijab is the hijab that goes back and forth many a times, practiced by the late Benazir Bhutto. In other words, the hijab does what? The hijab is there sometimes and it's not there another times. There is the Maulana hijab. What is that hijab? That's the hijab that is put on when the Maulana comes in weddings. Or there is the hijab known as the Quran hijab, that we find sisters sitting in a gathering or the nikah ceremony, and all of a sudden the Quran is recited, and the sisters that are not wearing hijab all scramble for something to put on their hair, like for instance tissues or whatever, as if they need to cover their hair. And as soon as the Quran ends, khalas, everything is fine, back to normal. These are the definitions that sometimes exist. Question arises here, what type of hijab is actually Islam talking about? Is the Iraqi hijab, or the Afghani hijab, or the Khoja hijab, or the Pakistani hijab? Which type of hijab is acceptable and which is not? And the answer is, any type of Islamic dress code that fulfills these conditions is considered hijab. One cannot say that a certain type is indeed the only one and that should be practiced. All types needs to be understood and presented before this general main criteria that we have laid down. Today we have individuals who come forward and not only question hijab, but also at the same time stop their sisters or their daughters adorning it. I was reading and I came across a story of a lady living in an Arab country. She went to school, she was quite young, 11, 12 years old, past the bulugh age. In other words, she needed to be wearing the hijab, yet she was not. Her teacher spoke to her about hijab at school. She went back home. She said to her mother, "Oh, my mother, today I've become inspired. Today my teacher had told me about the significance of why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has made this particular dress code obligatory for females." Her mother said, "No, you're too young. You still have your life before you. When you go to secondary school, you will wear the hijab." She waited, she suffered, but she said, "I have to listen to my mother." When she entered secondary education, she came to her mother. Her mother said to her, "Yet at the same time that you want to wear the hijab, I feel that you need to focus on your studies, and hijab maybe distracts you. Do not wear the hijab." Until one day she was fed up with this type of excuse. She said to her mother, "From now on, I am not going to college or school. I am staying at home unless I'm given the permission to wear the hijab." Her mother called her father. Her father was known for his anger. He should have listened to yesterday's lecture. Her father came forward and was angry. He said to her, "What are you doing?" She replied back that, "I do not want to go to school unless I wear the hijab." So it is said that he came and he hit her very strongly to the extent that she fell onto the ground and the tears started to trickle down her cheeks. And at that moment, she lifted her head towards the sky and said, "Oh Allah, I have only you." You know, sometimes we have this dua of the mazloom, the dua of the oppressed. We are told the dua of the mazloom is always answered by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala listens to the one that his heart is broken, that they have no one to turn to other than the Almighty tabaraka wa ta'ala. The father said, "No way. Tomorrow you go to school, and if you do not, I will kill you. And you will not be wearing the hijab. It is not for you. It is backward. It is for those who are religious." At that moment, she said, "I will not." And the abuse continued. And what she used to do is, when her father would go inside the room, she would pretend that she was asleep so that her father would not hit her, would not abuse her. To the extent that one day she said, "When my father came inside the room, I pretended that I was asleep. He sat next to me and all of a sudden I saw him crying. That's the moment that I knew that Allah has answered my dua." After a while, she fell ill. And her mother came to her and said, "How are you doing?" She said, "I'm recovering." Her mother said, "Are you still determined to wear the hijab?" She said, "Yes, oh my mother, I will never leave this house until I wear it. Why should I disobey Allah? Why should I do something that displeases Allah? I am somebody who has found the truth and the path of righteousness. I will never leave this particular building until I adorn it." At that moment, the mother calls the father. The father comes in. He has with him a bag. He sits next to his daughter. He takes out a scarf and says to her, "Oh my daughter, this is your power and this is yours. From this day, you are a muhajjaba. From this day, you shall adorn the hijab. You have been right and we have been wrong. In you, we have become inspired. And in you, we have seen the determination to please Allah and to stand strong in the face of anyone who prevents you from practicing your faith." In other words, that as believing men and women, we are all part of this equation. We are all having a responsibility to encourage each other, to strengthen our iman and understanding. In which way? We are told that once you understand that hijab is obligatory, one needs to reflect upon the fact that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is a wise being. And a wise being will not legislate anything except that it has hikmat in it. Except that it has wisdom in it. Allah will not make it wajib for our sisters to adorn the Islamic dress code unless it is in their favor, because Allah wants to honor them and give them dignity and respect. That's why hijab has been made obligatory. Once you recognize this, you move to the third level. The third level is what is known as taslim. So here we have spoken about three steps. The first is ilm, understanding that hijab is obligatory. Second is tawakkul, knowing that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and whatever He legislates is truth and it is wise. And the third is taslim. What is this taslim? Somebody once argued and said, why is it that, for instance, we cannot have boyfriends and girlfriends? Why can't we live like the non-Muslims? Why can't we do whatever we desire? And the simple answer and the question that I posed to them was, what is the definition of a Muslim? Their response was, a Muslim is the one who prays, fasts, gives zakat and khums and goes to hajj. I said, wrong. That's not a Muslim. That is a result of being a Muslim. A Muslim is he or she who submits his affairs before Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Islam is submission. Islam is complete obedience. Meaning what? Meaning that Allah is your creator. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants the best for you and I. He has legislated the sharia so that we live our lives in order to seek perfection and to attain Jannah. And therefore you submit. Fala وربك لا يؤمنون حتى يحكموك فيما شجر بينهم. Allah says, by God, they will never be considered believers until they take you, Ya Rasulullah, as a judge between them. ثم لا يجدون حرجا مما في أنفسهم مما قضيت. Then they do not find anything in themselves which is a problem after you make a ruling. ويسلموا تسليما. And they submit entirely. This notion of submission is an unbelievably wonderful concept, because a believer in the magnificent only creator, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, will submit their affairs before Him. So this, the idea that is existing in this particular school of thought, is understanding this area. The second part that is normally given is, let's look at the society around us that do not wear the hijab or do not believe in hijab to start off with. You see, today we have this movement in the West which is known as the sexualization of society. Women are used as objects of desire for the whims and for the likes of whom? Of men. You find adverts online and on the streets and on the television screen using women as cheap objects for men to pleasure themselves, and therefore women are being sold as cheap objects in society. At the same time, there were studies that were conducted in Europe when they asked a few children, and they asked them and they said, what do you say about how you feel? There is a problem out there when it comes to self-esteem. They asked him, how do you feel? 55% of what? Of 15 to 20 year old girls said, we do not like the way we look. We don't like the way we look. Why? There's this constant pressure. Sometimes peer pressure, society pressure, pressure from celebrities. They want to look the best way as possible. And therefore you'll find the makeup or the cosmetic industry very much thriving, continuously looking for ways in which people, and especially the ladies, would present themselves. And it is always unsatisfactory. Always you're looking for more. Why? Because they're lacking self-esteem. It's about the pleasing others and for others to say that you look nice. It's for others to somewhat compliment certain individuals the way they look. The ethos of hijab in the religion of Islam, and please focus on this, because this is how we should approach the subject. This is how we should understand the need to adorn hijab, is to look at what the Quran and the teachings of the Ahlul Bayt say is the philosophy of this particular obedience. Number one, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in the Quran says, ذَلِكَ أَزْكَى لَهُمْ, when he speaks about hijab. That is pure for them. Allah wants to purify human beings. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants to cleanse them, wants to protect them, wants to give them a special honor. And therefore this zakat of the soul, the Quran says, this zakat of the soul is achieved through hijab. So once we understand that the purity of the heart and the purity of the soul is attained through this form of obedience, then it helps us to put everything what? Everything in perspective. Number one. Number two, Allah says in the Quran what? He says that one of the ideas that emerges in hijab is ذَلِكَ أَدْنَى أَن يُعْرَفْنَ. Hijab is made wajib. Do you know why it's been made wajib? The Quran tells you and I why it's been made wajib. It's been made wajib because Allah has chosen females, and Allah says in the Quran, I want the females who are Muslims and wear the hijab to stand out, because they become ambassadors for the religion of Islam. Because them, through them people recognize that the religion of Islam is a religion of chastity, modesty, taqwa, piety, God consciousness. Allah says in the Quran that they will immediately be known for their devotion, for their sincerity, for their adherence to the faith. And there is a reward for them. I always say to the sisters, I say, sisters, Allah has chosen you. Do not become disloyal to this special selection from Allah. Do not abandon this particular responsibility that Allah has fallen on your shoulders. And majority of the times, not on the men, although there is a responsibility that we will discuss later that is considered the hijab of the men. But when we speak about the hijab of our sisters, we mean that Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala wants them to be known as individuals who represent the faith and the religion of Islam, and for their true beauty, which is what? The beauty of the heart, to take precedence, that their quality emerges as far as their akhlaq and as far as their devotion and as far as their spirituality is concerned. That is their true beauty, that Islam and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants our sisters to emerge with. And I say to them that when it comes to this idea, think about it. When every time you adorn the hijab without saying anything, without doing anything, you get thawab and reward. It's like a clock that is running with continuous reward. Men don't have this favor. Women don't have necessarily, our gents do not have this particular ni'mah that Allah has granted upon the women, that when they adorn the hijab is continuous reward as long as they are wearing it. Continuous reward. Number two. Number three, Quran says what? ذَلِكَ أَدْنَى أَن يُعْرَفْنَ فَلَا يُؤْذَيْنَ, so that they are not molested, so that they are not picked upon. Today, sometimes we see in society, outside our communities, that women are picked upon. Women are used as objects. Islam wants to protect the women and create this fortress, which is known as hijab, so that the modesty and the chastity is preserved. And that the chances that they will be attacked, the chances that they will be picked on, as far as their bodies is concerned, and as far as how they are, is indeed greatly reduced. And indeed studies have shown this. Studies have shown that when it comes to females who cover up their bodies, of course they draw much less attention by men and others with filthy minds than those who reveal their bodies, of course. Therefore, the religion of Islam comes forward with this idea that indeed it is better in many shapes or forms for our sisters, as far as it preserves for them this family unit also. It was drawn to my attention that Ayatollah Shaheed Mutahhari, in his book about hijab, speaks about what? He speaks about the fact that hijab preserves the family unit. In which way does it preserve the family unit? It ensures that our sisters indeed only reveal themselves for their husband, for their father, as far as, you know, presentation is concerned. Yet it keeps family strong and cohesive. and it enables the family to remain indeed in the path of the obedience of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Therefore, understanding the background behind hijab is of great importance for us to be convinced. Yet, there is another school of thought that comes forward and says, this physical hijab by itself is not enough. Why? They say it needs to be coupled with another form of hijab known as social hijab. What is social hijab? Social hijab is applicable to both men as well as women. Both sides need to understand what social hijab is. Social hijab is essentially understanding the dangers of unnecessary mixing, glancing, speaking which involves lusts and desires, anything that involves the interaction between the males and the females in which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is displeased with and Sharia has prohibited. Social hijab is indeed applicable in our day-to-day lives, but especially on social networking sites. Today, most of the lives of many human beings are dictated and a great deal of time is spent on sites such as Facebook and Twitter, on email and on chat sites. Today, more than 1 billion human beings has Facebook accounts. Today, every 20 minutes, more than 1.5 million pictures are uploaded on Facebook. Today, many human beings, many people who have Facebook accounts continuously desire and like to be liked. They love somebody to like their comment or to like their picture or to like, for instance, whatever they have posted. But the problems that have emerged, and there's absolutely nothing wrong with having a Facebook account or a Twitter account, and it, like a knife, it can be used to cut an apple or to kill a human being. Facebook has good usage. It can be used for the propagation of the religion of Islam, for spreading of the madhab of Ahlul Bayt, for talking and understanding and posting videos and lectures and sermons. Yet at the same time, we find that sometimes interactions that take place or incidents that occur leaves a lot to be desired. Facebook has come with its own problems. Like what? I was reading about Facebook and what has happened, that a lady here in the United States, when one of her friends defriended her, she became very upset and she went and burnt her house. She burnt her house because she was defriended. Or for instance, there was a man who was getting married to his wife. When the priest said to them, would you, or to him, do you take her as your wife? And he said, yes. At that moment when the priest said to them that you are both husband and wife, it is said that he said to the priest, hold on 1 minute. He picked up his phone and updated his status on Facebook, married. That we have this attachment to social networking sites today. Yet the problem between our sisters and our brothers, especially those who are not married on Facebook, it sometimes has to be drawn into the attention, or we need to speak about it. In which way? Sometimes our sisters post pictures of themselves, inappropriate images of themselves and in their family members. And in many occasions, they have friends which are female and non-mahram. And the problem is that our brothers then will do what? They like it. And not only do they like it, I was told that once a sister placed a picture on Facebook about her and a brother who was a non-mahram commented. He says, Alhamdulillah, now I can appreciate Allah's beauty. Can you imagine that the stuff that is going on, sometimes we have to be careful about, because shaitan comes through different channels. You might argue that where is it in the Quran or in the Sunnah that says posting pictures in Facebook and liking them is haram? There's nothing there that says, but our ulama said you have to be careful because the tools of the shaitan are sometimes quite powerful and we succumb to them and we at the same time become weak, thinking that there is no influence and we give in to the temptations. Therefore, social hijab is of the great importance. Why? Look at the Quran, chapter 24, verse number 30. Allah says, قُلْ لِلْمُؤْمِنِينَ يَغُضُّوا مِنْ أَبْصَارِهِمْ. Say to the believing men to lower their gaze. وَيَحْفَظُوا فُرُوجَهُمْ. And to guard their private parts. And then the verse goes on to say what? وقل للمؤمنات يغضضن من أبصارهن ويحفظن فروجهن. It starts off with the men, then it moves on to the females. In other words, if we are to have a healthy, strong, faithful community based on the teachings of Islam, it will have to be efforts when it comes to hijab and social elements of the hijab. We need to work together. We need to work as far as the males and the females, our brothers and the sisters. It's a common ground, it's a common objective. It's a common goal that we should be seeking to establish in our lives. Because when we look at this subject, at the same time, there are a number of excuses that are presented. When it comes to discussion surrounding hijab, some of our sisters, especially when it comes to the physical hijab, they give excuses. They say that I'm not wearing the hijab, or I'm not wearing it properly, for a number of reasons. The first reason is, and this is one of probably the most common, they say that I am a believer in the heart, and it only matters in the eyes of Allah what's inside my heart. Brother, I'm good in the heart, they say. It doesn't matter about my physical appearance, because Allah does not look at my physical appearance, He looks at what's in my heart. Once I said this particular excuse to a scholar, one of the teachers, and he said to me, ask the sister, do you know what's inside your heart? Can you say for sure that your heart is good, number one? Can you for definite say that your heart is pure, or does Allah only know what the state of our hearts is? Number two, Islam is not a part-time religion. Islam is not a religion of taking whatever it suits us and abandoning whenever we dislike it. Islam is comprehensive. Islam is a system of life. Islam ensures that every element of our existence is covered in the eyes of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And therefore, we cannot be of individuals who give excuses to say that, for instance, what? That whatever's in my heart is sufficient. Because this is against the teachings, number one. And number two, we are not even sure about the position of our qalb anyway. What is the other excuse that some of our sisters give when it comes to not adorning the Islamic dress code or not putting it on properly? They say, it is something that I will do later on in life. When I retire, when I become 50 or 60 years of age, I will wear the best hijab that you will see. But today, I can't, because of pressures, because of the society, because of my work, because of university, I am unable to wear the hijab. This is an excuse that they give, don't they? What's the answer to this? If any of our sisters can guarantee that they are able to live for a few more moments after they say the statement, then Bismillah. Then allow them to do whatever you want. Let me tell you of a story, a real story that happened in Alexandria in Egypt. That a lady who was not wearing hijab attended a majlis, attended a lecture, and she was inspired and she decided to wear the hijab. She said to her friend, I want to wear the hijab from now. Her friend said, okay, let's go home and I'll buy you some good Islamic hijab. She said, no, I'm so convinced I'm not leaving from the door unless I wear the hijab. She said, where am I going to get you a hijab here from? She said, go and find me from a shop or somewhere, or borrow from your house and bring it. She said, fine, stay in the mosque. I will go to my house. I'll bring you my a scarf and anything else that would cover your body, and I will come back. When she came back, she gave her the hijab, she wore it. They were crossing the street, and she was crossing the street. A car didn't see her. She was knocked over and she passed away. Imagine. Imagine that a human being sometimes becomes so arrogant, thinking that they are in control of their lives. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala takes their lives away in a split second. May Allah bless a 17-year-old girl by the name of Sakina, who indeed passed away and shocked the London Shia Ithna Ashari community over 2 months ago. 17 years of age, she was crossing the road in one of the streets in North London at 1 p.m. on a Friday. An 84-year-old man was driving. He did not see her. He knocked her over. She had her head onto the pavement and she passed away.
17 years of age, all her life before her. What we need to recognize is that death does not distinguish between the old and the young, between males and females. Death can strike at any moment. Therefore, what position are we in now? And can we guarantee that when maut comes and the malakul maut takes our soul away, we can delay it and make the all-important decisions in our lives? Can we guarantee that or not? The other objection or excuse that is normally given is what? How am I supposed to wear hijab when the entire society and at work and everyone else will ridicule me? Or I'll be subject to mockery or abuse. Or I may not get the job. Or I may not get married. These are excuses that are sometimes presented. The Quran gives us the answer. الَّذِينَ يَتَّخِذُونَ الْكَافِرِينَ أَوْلِيَاءَ مِن دُونِ الْمُؤْمِنِينَ Allah says there are those who consider the disbelievers more worthy to like and to follow and to become obedient over the believers. أَيَبْتَغُونَ عِنْدَهُمُ الْعِزَّةِ Allah is questioning. He says, are you looking for izzat from them? What is izzat? Izzat is dignity, recognition, honor. To be able to somewhat be given the pat on the back. Allah says in the Quran, are you looking for izzat from non-believers? Then in another verse, Allah says, فَإِنَّ الْعِزَّةَ لِلَّهِ جَمِيعًا Or in another verse, Allah says that if you are looking for izzat, فَإِنَّ الْعِزَّةَ لِلَّهِ وَلَرَسُولِهِ وَلِلْمُؤْمِنِينَ Izzat and power and might and honor and dignity belongs to Allah, to His Messenger and to the believers. Why? Because they have iman. And that's what gives them izzat. Iman is what gives you dignity and honor. Not what others think. Number one. Number two. This feeling of shame or embarrassment. Picture yourself. Would you like to be embarrassed in this world, which is temporary or transient? Not that you need to be embarrassed. Not that you need to be in any shape or form, somewhat withdrawn from society because of your hijab. As we mentioned, hijab is a symbol of liberation. It helps the lady break the shackles that exist out there in certain parts and in certain societies. Yet if you feel that indeed is something that one cannot practice, then think about the Day of Judgment. Any human being standing before Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and the shame that the deeds will be read out before mankind and the repercussions thereafter. Which one should one fear about being embarrassed or shameful? Shamefulness on the Day of Judgment or shamefulness in dunya, which is temporary or transient? These have to be borne in mind when the human being comes forward to analyze and to give excuses. Yet at the same time, the approach that is sometimes given or utilized when it comes to hijab leaves a lot to be desired. In which way? Never should anybody who does not wear hijab be looked down upon. Never should an individual be indeed mistreated just because they do not wear hijab. Anybody from whatever community which have not decided to wear the hijab should be encouraged, should be indeed helped, should be supported to take that active process. And it involves the friends, it involves the parents, it involves those that they're close to. Indeed, it involves the men, it involves the women, it involves the community leaders. But it's essentially, we need to rise to the responsibility to understand that one of the objectives of Karbala was to establish hijab. In which way, you ask me? I say to you, read what happened on the 10th of Muharram. That Sayyid al-Shuhada Aba Abdullah al-Husayn salawatullahi wa salamuhu alayhi. When he emerged, he said to his family members, he said to them, make sure that you remain covered because the enemy will attack you and will wish to take away whatever belongings you have. These are found in the Maqatil. That Imam al-Husayn alayhi salam specially emphasized the adorning of the hijab for his family members and for some of the wives of the companions that they were there. Number one. Number two, the narrations tell us that Aba Abdullah al-Husayn, when he reached the riverbank of Furat and when he felt the water, when at that moment he turned back and he recognized that his family were being attacked, he threw the water without drinking a single drop of it and returned in order to protect the honor of his family. in order to protect their dignity. Why? Because of his concern for their, for their what? For their hijab. Look at how Sayyida Zainab fought and stood for the principles of hijab all the way through, from the moment that their hijab was taken away from them, all the way to the courtyard of Ubaydullah ibn Ziyad and the courtyard of Yazid ibn Muawiyah. She continuously mentioned this particular crime that was committed against the Ahlul Bayt and their women, continuously highlighting this. When Sa'd ibn Sahl al-Jabiri, Sa'd ibn Sahl al-Sa'idi, a companion of the Holy Prophet, he said, I was in Sham and I saw people celebrating. I knew it was not Eid. And I then asked, what is happening? I was told that a few prisoners are coming, people who are rebels. I looked up and all of a sudden I recognized the daughters of Ali and the granddaughters of the Prophet. I do not wish to go into Masa'ib yet, but I wish to tell you that this man came to Sayyida Zainab and said to her, O Sayyida, do you want me to do anything? Sayyida said, one thing I want you to do. If you have some money, give it to the man who is carrying the head of my beloved brother Hussein, so that he moves towards somewhere else, not next to us, because I do not like people to look at us. All that she was concerned by is her chastity, her modesty, her honor, her dignity that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has had indeed granted her. Therefore Karbala, therefore Sayyida Zainab, Aba Abdullah, was a movement indeed to establish the principles of hijab. And how wonderful it is that we take from this commemoration of Aba Abdullah al-Hussein an important decision to A, either adorn the hijab, or B, to perfect our hijab, or to seek perfect or correct our social hijab in terms of our interactions between brothers and sisters. This will indeed be something that we can instigate in the month of Muharram and make a transformation. And look to individuals for inspiration who were youth like Aliyyin al-Akbar. Aliyyin al-Akbar, according to many narrations, was 27 years of age, although there is a dispute. However, Aliyyin al-Akbar was a man who had entirely and completely dissolved himself in the obedience of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and was ready for everything that came before him. The narrations tell us that on the way to Karbala, Imam al-Hussein, who was riding on his horse, stopped for a moment. Ali al-Akbar was next to him. He was concerned why Aba Abdullah had stopped. Imam al-Hussein closes his eyes and then opens it. Ali al-Akbar says to him, oh my father, what has happened? Imam al-Hussein said, I saw a dream in which death is approaching and is taking the lives of us and my companions and Ahl al-Bayt. Ali al-Akbar says, oh my father, are we not on the path of truth al-haq? Imam al-Hussein said, indeed we are. Ali al-Akbar said, let me tell you, oh my father, that we are not afraid of death. If we approach death, or death comes towards us. This was the valor and the courage and the determination and the obedience and the submission of Ali al-Akbar, who was the first who emerged from Bani Hashim on the 10th of Muharram. The narrations tell us that in the morning, at the time of the Fajr, Imam al-Hussein instructed Ali to perform the adhan. And when he recited the adhan, the whole campsite of Imam al-Hussein and some members from the army of Umar ibn Sa'd began to weep and cry, because it reminded them of the voice of Rasulullah. It reminded them about the time of the Holy Messenger. And when Ali al-Akbar came, he sought permission from his father. He wanted to go to the battlefield. Narrations tell us that Imam al-Hussein would normally reject the others' permission and would say, go back. But for Ali al-Akbar, the only thing he did was that he hugged him, and there was a special farewell between them. They both fell onto the ground, weeping and crying, and eventually unconscious. When Ali al-Akbar moved towards the battlefield, Imam al-Hussein lifted up his hands towards the heavens,
and said, Allahumma ashhad ala ha'ula'i al-qawm. Oh Allah, be witness against these people. فَقَدْ بَرَزَ إِلَيْهِمْ غُلَامٌ أَشْبَهُ النَّاسِ بِرَسُولِكَ مُحَمَّدٍ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَآلِهِ وَسَلَّمْ خَلْقًا وَخُلُقًا وَمَنْطِقًا. Oh Allah, be witness that a man has just emerged to fight the enemy. He resembles the Holy Prophet in his appearance. He resembles the Holy Prophet in his speech. He resembles the Holy Prophet in his akhlaq. وَكُنَّا إِذَا اشْتَقْنَا إِلَىٰ رَسُولِكَ نَظَرْنَا إِلَيْهِ. Every time we want to look at the Holy Prophet and we have the desire to remember how Rasulullah looked, we looked at Ali al-Akbar. Ali al-Akbar fights bravely, courageously, killing many of the enemies of Allah. At that moment, one narration states that his mother Layla, she is looking at the facial expressions of Imam al-Hussein in order to monitor how her son Ali al-Akbar is doing in the battlefield. Imagine Aba Abdullah al-Hussein, all of a sudden his facial expression changes. He feels that there is something wrong. She says to him, Sayyidi Aba Abdullah, has there anything happened? Is there something that is misfortunate that has occurred on my son Ali? Imam al-Hussein said, there is an enemy that has come to fight him that I'm afraid might hurt him. Oh Layla, if you wanted to see your son once more, therefore the dua of the mother is answered by Allah. Go and pray to Allah if you wanted to see Ali al-Akbar. Allahu Akbar. Narrations tell us that Layla went inside the tent. She sat next to the prayer mat. She took off her hijab. She looked up to the heavens. She wept and cried, Ilahi bi ghurbati Aba Abdullah. Ilahi bi dhulmati Aba Abdullah. Oh Allah, Aba Abdullah is alone. Oh Allah, Aba Abdullah has been abandoned. أو راد يوسف ليعقوب رد إلي بني علي. Oh, the one who returned Yusuf to Yaqub, please return me my son Ali. The narrations tell us that Ali al-Akbar, he killed that enemy combatant. He returned back. He looked at his father and says, Oh father, هل من شربة ماء? Is there any water? Because the armor is heavy and I wish to fight. Imam al-Hussein said to him, My son Ali, fight in the way of Allah, for surely you will be quenched by Rasulullah from the pond of Kothar. One narration tells us that Ali al-Akbar came next to Aba Abdullah. Imam al-Hussein looked at how thirsty he was. He said to him, Bunay Ali, my son Ali, come next to me. Why, oh my father, what is it that you want me to do? He said, take some saliva from my mouth and put it in your mouth. Ali al-Akbar looks at Imam al-Hussein's mouth. He says, Aba Abdullah, your mouth is even drier than I am. You're even more thirsty than I am. Allahu Akbar. Imam al-Hussein says to Ali, Oh Ali, go to your mother. She is waiting for you in the tent. Ali al-Akbar comes towards the tent. He sits next to his mother. Layla had gone unconscious. Ali al-Akbar picks up the head of his mother and places it on his lap. He starts to weep and cry, and the tears fall on the cheeks of Layla. Layla wakes up. Is this my son? Is this Ali? Has Ali al-Akbar returned? He says, My mother, indeed, I am your son Ali. She says, My son Ali. What did she want from him? Imagine, ask yourself, what did Layla want from Ali al-Akbar? She says, Oh Ali, stand up for me. Why, my mother? She says, I want my eyes to look at you for the final time. I want my eyes to be
satisfied just to look at you, my son Ali. Allahu Akbar, Ali al-Akbar looks and knows, moves towards the battlefield. He fights and kills many of the enemies. Historians say that a man said, by God, I will make his father mourn over him. They said to him, look at the people surrounding him. Are you not suffused by that? He said, no. And behind Ali al-Akbar, he came behind him and struck him on his head. Ali al-Akbar then falls onto his horse. The blood from the head of Ali al-Akbar fills the horse's face. And instead of taking the horse, instead of taking Ali al-Akbar to the caravan site of Imam al-Hussein, the horse takes him to the other side. They all surround him. One man stabs him with a sword. Another man hits him with a stone. A third person plunges a spear onto him. He calls out, Alayka minni salam, Aba Abdullah, Am hadha jaddi Rasulullah, Qad saqani sharbatan min al-ma' La azma'u ba'daha abada. My father Hussein, peace and blessings be upon you. This is my grandfather. He has quenched my thirst. Imam al-Hussein narrations tell us that he left from his campsite, but he went to the opposite direction. He was going completely the opposite direction. His daughter Sukaina said, my father, Aba Abdullah, we heard Ali al-Akbar voice on this way. He said, don't blame me, Sukaina. The voice of Ali has broken my heart. I have lost my direction. I do not know which direction to go. He comes and fights his son Ali al-Akbar into pieces, but breathing his last moments. He sits next to him, Bunay Ali, ala dunya ba'daka al-afa. My son Ali, what is the worth of dunya to live after you? It is so sad for your father to hear your cries but cannot help you. At that moment, narrations tell us that Ali al-Akbar was seen smiling on one side, and on another side he was seen grieving. Imam al-Hussein said to him, oh my son, why are you smiling on one's instance and grieving on the other? He says, my father, Aba Abdullah, on my right is my grandfather Rasulullah, quenching my thirst, but on the left is Sayyida Fatima, my grandmother. She is beating her head and slapping her cheeks. She is crying, Wa Husayna, Wa Abna, Wa Mazluma. And at that moment, the soul of Ali al-Akbar departs. Wa Aliya, Wa Mazluma, Wa Shahida. Imam al-Hussein wants to pick up the body of Ali and cannot. He calls and says, come and pick up the body of Ali because I cannot. He walks by himself. At that moment, Layla is waiting, Zainab is waiting, the daughters are waiting. Aba Abdullah, where is Ali al-Akbar?
ألا لعنة الله على القوم الظالمين وسيعلم الذين ظلموا أي منقلب ينقلبون والعاقبة للمتقين وإنا لله وإنا إليه راجعون. نسألك اللهم وندعوك باسمك العظيم الأعظم الأعز الأجل الأكرم. يا الله يا الله يا الله يا الله يا الله يا رحمن يا رحيم يا مقلب القلوب ثبت قلوبنا على دينك. اللهم انصر الإسلام والمسلمين واخذل الكفر والمنافقين. اللهم دمر أعداء الدين. شافي مرضانا ومرضى المؤمنين والمؤمنات بحق مريض كربلاء زين العابدين وإلى أرواح المؤمنين والمؤمنات. رحم الله من قرأ الفاتحة. But before it aloud صلوات.
Hussein, 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 Hussein. Hussein, Hussein.
I am Ali Akbar, son of Hussein, son of Ali. I am Ali Akbar, son of Hussein, son of Ali. I am Ali Akbar, son of Hussein, son of Ali. I am Ali Akbar, son of Hussein, son of Ali. I am Ali Akbar, son of Hussein, son of Ali. I am Ali Akbar, son of Hussein,
son of Ali.
I am Ali Akbar, son of Hussein, son of Ali. I am Ali Akbar, son of Hussein, I am Ali Akbar, son of Hussein, son of Ali. I am Ali Akbar,
son of Hussein, son of Ali.
How dare you try and scare me? Death is sweeter than honey. I am Ali Akbar, son of Hussein, son of Ali. I am Ali Akbar, son of Hussein, son of Ali. I am Ali Akbar, son of Hussein, son of Ali. I am Ali Akbar,
son of Hussein, son of Ali.
Why do you want to spill my blood? You will spill the Prophet's blood if you cut. Why do you want to spill my blood? You will spill the Prophet's blood if you cut. Oh, look at me, see me, and stare at me. Tell me you don't see the blessed Nabi. I am Ali Akbar, son of Hussein, son of Ali. I am Ali Akbar, son of Hussein, son of Ali. I am Ali Akbar, son of Hussein,
son of Ali.
Allahu Akbar is the cry on the battlefield and in our salat. Allahu Akbar is the cry on the battlefield and in our salat. Allahu Akbar is the cry on the battlefield and in our salat. Allahu Akbar is the cry on the battlefield and in our salat. I will go and fight, not return. Who would be the one to give the other? I am Ali Akbar, son of Hussein, son of Ali. I am Ali Akbar, son of Hussein, son of Ali. I am Ali Akbar, son of Hussein, son of Ali. I am Ali Akbar,
son of Hussein, son of Ali.
Father, I'm so proud to be your son. In this world and the next, we are one. Father, I'm so proud to be your son. In this world and the next, we are
one.
Father, I'm so proud to be your son. In this world and the next, we are one. Father, I'm so proud to be your son. In this world
and the next, we are one.
Give love to my mother, Layla. Thank her for raising me with the love for Allah. I am Ali Akbar, son of Hussein, son of Ali. I am Ali Akbar, son of Hussein, son of Ali. I am Ali Akbar, son of Hussein, son of Ali. I am Ali Akbar, son of Hussein,
son of Ali.
Father, wipe off your tears. I am right here. Please come see me. Father, wipe off your tears. I am right here. Please come see me. Father, wipe off your tears. I am right here. Please come see me. Father, wipe off your tears. I am right here. Don't weep, my dear Father. Heaven is near, for I am Shaheed. I am Ali Akbar, son of Hussein, son of Ali. I am Ali Akbar, son of Hussein,
son of Ali.
I am Ali Akbar, son of Hussein, son of Ali. I am Ali Akbar, son of Hussein, son of Ali. How dare you try and scare me, for death is sweeter than honey. I am Ali Akbar, son of Hussein, son of Ali. I am Ali Akbar, son of Hussein, son of Ali. I am Ali Akbar, son of Hussein, son of Ali. I am Ali Akbar, son of Hussein, son of Ali. Ya Hussein.
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 Allahumma salli ala Muhammad wa ali Muhammad. All the young ones, please shake Shaykh Ali's hand before you leave. I'd like to request this.